So today's lecture, it's on that topic. What's fascism? It's a topic that I'd like for us to begin to approach in a very historical way, meaning I want us to think very clearly using a range of historical documents rooted in the 1920s primarily that gave rise to a political movement which we can characterize as fascism, and later that movement turned into something else which we would characterize as totalitarianism. And we'll talk about that transformation. How do you go from fascism to totalitarianism? What's involved? And particularly the role of the rise of Nazism in this process. One of the best definitions, I think, on trying to define fascism is by a historian by the name of Roger Griffin. And I should say, you don't have to copy everything down word for word. Every slide I already put on the CCLE website, so all these slides, there's a nice little PDF file called Slides, Week 1. They're all there. And so you can get it from there. But if you want to, of course, extract keywords and concepts, that would be great. So a revolutionary form, I'm going to help you parse this a little bit, a revolutionary form of nationalism. There's a revolution involved. There's a political and social and cultural change. It's nationalistic because it's about something about a nation. It has many dimensions, political, social, ethical, cultural. Has an idea of creating a new national community, but from an existing or perhaps submerged community, a community that maybe has been imperiled or perhaps disenfranchised or maybe not heard. It establishes new elites, meaning new leadership. It doesn't like the existing leadership. These values are heroic because they imagine a kind of rebirth, a kind of greatness. There's a core myth always in fascism, and that myth has to do with its populist nature, a kind of a populist uprising, usually again of a disenfranchised group. In the case of German fascism, often these were soldiers coming back from the war, they were workers, they were lower middle class, and they were largely rural. That is to say, they weren't coming from cities. Cities were often seen as places for cosmopolitan values, progressive values. They were seen as Jewish, they were seen as intellectual, they were seen as variously more educated. And so Hitler knew that much of the power and the disaffection that came from the First World War was going to come from parts of the population, again, primarily lower middle class, workers, soldiers, soldiers' families. This was the popular uprising. It was always imagined as a kind of catharsis, a kind of rebirth. And the last part is very important, stem the tide of decadence, because there's a sense of fallenness as well. For Germany in World War I, that fallenness was World War I, and all the strictures that the Versailles Treaty placed on Germany in terms of reparations, in terms of taking away colonies, in terms of putting strictures on the military, and the fact of the matter is, you have 4 million wounded war veterans returning to Germany. You have almost 2.5 million men killed in the war, Germans fighting, and you have a real sense of a country in tremendous political, cultural, economic turmoil. That's the crisis, and the sense of fallenness or decadence also usually has a pointer at it. Someone has caused this. That's the scapegoat. Fascism always needs a scapegoat. It always needs someone or a group to blame. And we'll come back to that. So, I'm going to give you a bunch of definitions here. A lot of words, I know. We're going to come back to this the entire day today. So, elements of fascism. If I was to distill a bunch of elements from German fascism, I'd start with that first one, the rebirth of a nation, out of some kind of decline or decadence. A sense of being able to reinvent and make it great. A heroic leader. A heroic leader that can form a new national community and save that community. Scapegoats, blame for decline, they have to be excluded. Germany in 1920s, it was systematically the Jews, and we'll look at the ideology around that. It's popular, it's populist. Often it appeals to racism and nativism, a sense of belonging. It's our country, it's ours, we need to take it back again. Someone has taken it from us. Now, the other parts about this return to order are very interesting. Social order, political order, hierarchy, usually through militarism, discipline, I would say family and the values associated with family, patriarchy, and purity. Patriarchy, fascism, you'll see, is a very masculinist movement. It's a kind of wedding of militarism, masculinity, patriarchy, and racial purity. Those are all elements of German fascism. In this regard, it's very socially conservative, right? It looks back to establish these other values, these values that are generally hierarchical in terms of, you know, patriarchy, heteronormativity, and things like that. And we'll look actually at, we'll see this in a minute. But at the same time, it's also progressive and technologically modern. What's very interesting about German fascism is the way in which it used new media to get its message across. Hitler was the master of using radio and film and creating mass spectacles and rallies in order to create a kind of sense of the inevitability of his message. Okay? These mass rallies were documented thoroughly in Leni Riefenstahl's film. You saw this. They also used propaganda to demonize the scapegoats. You saw this in the way that they depicted the Jews. And this goes all the way back from his original articulations of this ideology in 1919 and stays there until his dying words in 1945. Finally, fascism changes to something else when terror becomes the way in which the government functions. This is extremely important because at some point, something happens, and in the case of Germany, this happens very early in 1933, you have a crisis moment. And it's a political crisis. In this case, it's the fire in the German parliament building, the Reichstag. It's blamed on the communists, but it gives Hitler the ruse to eliminate all the checks and balances that were in place in the democratic regime of the Weimar Republic. This is a critical moment. Fascism, in order to accelerate its form of government as terror, needs this moment of crisis to get rid of freedoms. When it does so, it changes from fascism to totalitarianism because you don't have any checks and balances left. Okay, so that's where we're going. Not exactly a happy story, but one which we want to know about. So I'm going to start with ideology and race, because when Hitler came, I wouldn't say even came to power, he wasn't in power at all in 1919, but when Hitler began to explore his worldview publicly, the very first time he did was in a letter written to a German soldier by the name of Adolf Gemlich. Hitler had served in World War I, had fought on behalf of Germany, had been wounded, had returned to Munich in September of 1919, and he was asked by a captain, a man named Karl Mayer, to write a response to a soldier, a guy named Adolf Gemlich, about the army's position on the Jewish question. We mentioned this last time, that there is a Jewish question in Germany, a Judenfrage. What is the army's position on this? And so it was a letter written to a particular person, but in fact it had a much more public resonance. This letter is actually typewritten. The original, believe it or not, exists in Los Angeles at the Simon Wiesenthal Center, the Museum of Tolerance here. I believe you can see the letter. It's signed by Adolf Hitler. What he says is that Jewry represents a danger for our folk. Folk in German is the word for our ethnic community. Generally, it means the Germans. There's a danger. He imagines as well that anti-Semitism can't just be something like an emotional thing. Oh, we Germans, people who subscribe to this, hate the Jews for emotional reasons. He says you have to hate them for rational reasons. And this is very interesting. He imagines anti-Semitism as a political movement grounded in rational arguments. Now, what are those arguments? Those arguments are generally based on things that they consider to be facts. The fact that he says that Jews are a tuberculosis, that they leech, they're an enemy race, they're an alien race, they're a leech to bleed the nation. that they are somehow have a stranglehold over Germany, its economic system, and so forth. And I mentioned earlier, this is also, it's always very interesting, because Jews were never more than 1% of the total population. So you're talking about a very small group of people in Germany that then are systematically scapegoated as part of an ideology grounded in this hatred. So he calls for this anti-Semitism grounded in reason, to exclude Jews, take away their rights and privileges. The words in German, I think, are interesting to read because we had talked about Vernichtung last time, right? Annihilation. He uses the term a legal fighting, a gesetzliche Bekämpfung, and a Beseitigung. That is, a kind of a legal fighting against the Jews and a removal of their rights. He also talks about removing them from the populace, an Entfernung, a removal. And you can see some of these words like Bekämpfung and Beseitigung here, as well as this is the beginning of Entfernung, Ent, right there. So this is the beginning of an expression of a race-based ideology, right? This is something that's taken to a further step when he's in prison and writes his memoirs, Mein Kampf, and this piece on the Aryans that I gave you draws from one of the chapters in Mein Kampf. And here he's making a distinction between, okay, so here are these Jews, which are now these leeches for our national, for our nation. Who are we? Well, we Germans are Aryan. And Aryan is its own race. He considers them to be founders of cultures, drivers of progress. And to be honest, most of what Hitler says in Mein Kampf actually is not his own original thoughts, but goes back to a history of race-based thinking that found its origin in the mid-19th century and suffused not only Germany, but France, England, and eventually made its way to the United States. And so much of the thinking about a hierarchy of races, as if some races are more advanced and some races are more powerful and some races should rule the world and others should be subordinate, this goes back to 19th century pan-European thought. It's the justification for the colonialism in Africa. It's the justification for many race-based systems, including ones that existed in the late, well, throughout the 19th and into the 20th century in the United States. One of the most famous is by author de Gobineau, an essay on the inequality of the human races. And insofar as he places Europeans and white Europeans, and particularly Western and some, you know, eventually Aryans on the top, you have kind of a longer history of race-based thinking that gave rise to things like eugenics and paradigms that I think certainly informed many countries' own coming to terms with racism or ways in which racism informed the policies of those countries. He celebrates imperial and colonial history because, again, he believes that the strong will conquer the weak. He believes that the aboriginal races, the lower races, races in other Oriental or African parts of the world, we shouldn't mix, we Germans shouldn't mix with them, but we should conquer them because we're better. We're the founders of cultures and progress. This, again, is not entirely Hitler's idea. It's a much broader kind of thinking that's suffused, that really, I would say, goes back perhaps most programmatically to Gobineau, and he was a French intellectual. In any case, I give you some numbers about Jews in Germany. When Hitler is appointed chancellor in January of 1933, you have about 523,000 Jews in Germany out of 61 million people. And on the eve of World War I, about half of them managed to leave. And we'll talk a lot about, at some point, about why they chose to leave and if they could. So we'll talk a little about the context in which Hitler comes to power. I had mentioned last time that it wasn't as if Germany was already a fascist Nazi state in the 1920s. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It's a constitutional democracy called the Weimar Republic. Again, it's called Weimar because that's where the Constitution was drafted. The Constitution preserved rights for its citizens, rights just like the ones that we have in the United States. Freedom to assemble, freedom of speech, protect due process. You can't be imprisoned for no reason. The police can't come into your house and take your things away. Everyone is created equal. You have suffrage. You have extension of rights for all citizens. That's that's the constitutional democracy that existed in the Weimar Republic. It was in place between 1919 and 1933. At the same time, it was a time of great crisis and turmoil in Germany, partly because it's the aftermath of the First World War, partly because of the economic problems, and I'll talk about those in a second, partly because of massive political fragmentation between many different parties vying for power, and simultaneously, it turns out to be one of the most liberal, progressive, and in many ways innovative for culture. And so many of you may have heard of like Dada or the Bauhaus or German cinema during the 1920s, expressionist cinema. Some of the most radical and innovative and forward-looking cultural production happened during the in between the two wars. So with regard to political fragmentation, you have dozens of political parties existing, some on the far left, some on the far right. On the far left, you have the communists. On the far right, you have nationalist parties. You have, of course, the beginnings of the Nazi Party. 1920 is the date that it was established. It comes out of another party which already had existed called the Fatherland Party. That was a kind of already nationalist, sort of proto-fascist party. You also have people returning from the war, and they look, well, sort of like this artist Otto Dix depicts them. They sort of look like that. They're men, primarily men, who return from the front lines, shell-shocked, traumatized, have unimaginable injuries. World War I represented the first industrial war, a war of where you have mass annihilation. You have technologies of warfare that had never been used before that literally blew apart people's bodies, or you have people coming back from the war physically and psychically scarred. This is an artist named Otto Dix, a very famous kind of mixture of Dada and new objectivity, who tried to depict the historical reality using a sort of collage technique. You have the Bauhaus, one of the most innovative arts and architecture schools in the world, established in Weimar, eventually being closed by the Nazis in 1933. You have, this is a Dada, one of the first Dada exhibitions in Berlin, which was sort of mocking militarism, mocking, this is a soldier on the top there, artists sitting around trying to imagine a kind of response to the crisis of the war, one which was very anti-nationalistic through the arts. Great filmmakers like Fritz Lang, his very famous film Metropolis in 1927, The growth of cabaret culture, and I would say, and I'll point this out a little bit, LGBT rights, very progressive. The first LGBT organization in the world, founded in 1897, and really became the basis throughout the 1920s of advocacy for gay and lesbian and transgender citizens. And I should say, this was one of the only countries in the world where you have real advocacy, political enfranchisement for LGBT people at this time. All happening in the 1920s. The background, though, is this political fragmentation. Again, many different parties vying for power. And just among the, there are dozens, in fact, of political parties in Germany in the 1920s. The major parties that were getting seats in the Reichstag, the Reichstag is the parliament, were the Communist Party, the Social Democrats, the Catholic Center Party, the Nationalist Party, which allies with the Nazis, and then a number of other parties, particularly democratic parties, which steadily lose power. And so this, the DDP, is the German Democratic Party. And one of the interesting things you can see, in 1924, they have 102 seats. It's the number of seats they have in parliament. By 1932, they have only 22. And so a real kind of decline in the number of seats by the Democrats, and an increase in seats dramatically by the Nazis, as you can see, not until, though, really the 1930s. They didn't have much power in the 1920s, which is amazing, right? We talk about that this really quick rise to power. It happened really after the stock market crash. It really happened after 1929. When the German economy at that time was relatively stabilized and yet then rocked from the outside. So you have the Nazis gaining a tremendous number of seats in the Reichstag. You have the Nationalist Party not seeing some declines, but having to make a coalition with the Nazis. And then you see the communists gaining some seats. The communists are on the far left. And what happens is they're both against the Democrats. On the far left, you have the communists hating the Weimar Republic. On the far right, you have the nationalists hating the Weimar Republic. The communists would rather have the Republic destroyed and the Nazis in power, even though they have diametrically, politically different and economic views. And so this fragmentation gives rise to an opportunity. And it's an opportunity for a charismatic and, I would say, certainly politically extremely savvy leader to come into power. And that's precisely what happens. So again, to kind of recapitulate there, 1924, Nazi Party gets 3% of the vote. Tiny. No one took it really seriously. Hitler could rant and rave. He could write his memoir. He wasn't taken very seriously. And it was only until the late 1920s when partially he began to build up a paramilitary group of disaffected soldiers and other people who shared his worldview that he steadily began to gain more and more popular power. Multiple elections are happening this period. it's a very difficult period, partially because the president repeatedly dissolves the Reichstag. In Germany, just as a kind of piece of background, there's a chancellor and a president, the case today. So the chancellor is the head of the government, essentially the one who actually works with the legislators and the parliament. The president is more of a kind of nominal head of state, generally has less power. But in the case of Nazi Germany, the president would appoint the chancellor, and that chancellor would come from whatever party had won the majority in the elections. The problem is no party won the majority. The Nazis only got 37% in July of 1932. They got even less in November of 32. And so what happens is the parties start to make coalitions. They say, okay, well, the Nazis and the Nationalist Party, we agree with each other. The communists, you know, really are trying to undermine the entire thing. The Democrats have lost power. And Hindenburg appoints Hitler as chancellor, partly because he thinks that he can be controlled. If he's appointed to this position, he thinks that perhaps the very instability that has been seen would somehow stabilize. But the problem is, the context is that unemployment reaches a record high in 1933. You have a tremendous number of people disenfranchised. You have people very upset. You have people looking for answers, right? You have people wondering, you know, what's the future here? That Weimar Constitution, Weimar's not working. It's not working. We need a new paradigm. The other problem is that when Hindenburg dies in 1934, he's not replaced. There are no elections. And so Hitler consolidates power by becoming both chancellor and president. All right. So this is, again, it's kind of a quick tour of sort of how fascism comes to power, right? And I want to kind of now move us a little further along and kind of see really the early years of fascism in power. So this is moving away from how did it come to power to what did it do once it actually began to have the ability to do something. Well, I mentioned earlier that in order for Hitler to gain more power, and in order for the fascist state to consolidate its grip, something else had to happen. You had to get rid of the constitutional protections in the democratic constitution. Okay? What are those protections? Well, they're the right to your home, the right to privacy, the right to free speech. They're the right to assemble and protest. They're the right to form political parties and societies. It's the right to have property. It's the right to a trial. It's the right to have reasons given to you for why you've been imprisoned. All these things existed. All these basic rights existed in Weimar. But there was a state of emergency. What's the state of emergency? Someone lit the parliament on fire. The parliament building, the Reichstag, the capital in Germany. There's the fire. we to this day don't know exactly how that fire happened. It's blamed on the communists. It may very well have been set by the Nazis. The point here is that it's a pretext to suspend basic rights. So if you read in the readings, there was a decree by the Reich's president in February of 1933. This is less than a month after Hitler's in power. He comes to power January 30th. This is less than a month later. The Reichstag fire happens. Immediately, the very first thing is suspension of basic rights. It says Articles 114, 115, 117, 118, 123, 124, 153 of the Constitution of the German Reich are suspended until further notice. All those things, I wrote them out for you. That's what they are. Those are the things that they then, in the state of emergency, suspend until further notice. Well, they're never returned. Further notice is after 1945. What else is happening in Germany in 1933? What's happening like the first month? Well, you open a concentration camp. Most of us know something about the concentration camps. You've probably heard of a number in Germany: Dachau, Buchenwald, Bergen-Belsen, Sachsenhausen. First concentration camp opens outside of Munich. You can take the subway to get there. That's how close it is. It's established for two groups: communists and homosexuals. Interesting. Why the crackdown? Communists may make sense. Political dissidents, people that disagree with you, obviously a political party that you now want to outlaw. Homosexuals, because it goes back to that issue of patriarchy and social reform and hierarchy. All LGBT organizations outlawed. Remember, Germany was one of the most progressive places for LGBT rights in the 1920s. You have hundreds of bars, clubs, social organizations, publications. This is Magnus Hirschfeld on the right-hand side there. He's essentially the founding father of gay rights. He's the one who created the social humanitarian advocacy group, which was a group for gay rights, in 1897. He's the one who tried to repeal Germany's paragraph 175, which is a law outlawing homosexuality. He's the one who established in Berlin the Institute for Sexual Science. He invented the term transvestite. He thought that gender was a fluid concept and that there were 64 different variations of gender. Very progressive in the 1920s. He's the one who supported gay and lesbian rights, who supported women's rights. His institute is burned to the ground. Its holdings are destroyed. He was outside the country at the time. He can't come back. He never comes back to Germany. Gay bars in Germany. That's the El Dorado in Berlin. It says in German, here everything's okay, 1932. Shut down in 1933. This is a magazine called Die Freundin. It's a lesbian publication of friends. It just means friends, women friends. All LGBT publications banned. Again, we're talking less than 2 months after Hitler's in power. So the emergency laws, 2 days later, this goes to continue to accelerate things, accelerate the change. Emergency laws enacted in 1933. And this is really extraordinary because here, you have the elimination of checks and balances. In Germany, just like in the United States, you had three branches. You have an executive branch, have a legislative branch, you have a judiciary. The judiciary is the courts. Legislative branch is the parliament. Executive is the president and chancellor. They have checks and balances on one another. They check each other's power. No longer. Because laws can now be established outside the procedures of the Constitution and may deviate from the Constitution. The laws take effect the next day. They require no approval. Approval of legislation not required by any legislative body. These are the new laws. These laws trump the Constitution. Again, they exist because of the state of emergency that Germany has entered. It's haunting, right? This continues to accelerate. One of the things that happened in Nazi Germany is the creation of many laws. most of those laws were focused on the consolidation of power, the elimination of checks and balances, and the subjugation of the scapegoats that the Nazis wanted to eliminate. And so the other law that comes into power, and this is perhaps generally seen as a key turning point in the beginnings of the Holocaust, is to strip Jews of citizenship. So the only people that now are citizens in Germany as of September of 1935 are ones who can establish their citizenship based on German blood. Now this is amazing, right? So here you have a race-based biological definition of citizenship. You can't become naturalized, you can't become a citizen by, you know, all the procedures that are in place for how one would become a citizen of a state if you were an immigrant. But you can only establish it if biologically you have blood in your body that you can trace back to four grandparents who also have Aryan lineage. So citizenship now has changed. It's now based on blood. And that certification is given by the Reich, that is the Third Reich. The Third Reich is the Nazi party. And they will certify who is a citizen and who is not. So this causes also a huge issue. Some people aren't citizens. People that used to live in Germany and said they were, and they were citizens and could vote and hold property and hold elected office and serve in the military, everything else. Well, if you're not a citizen, you can't do those things anymore. Other thing the Nuremberg Law does is it prohibits marriage between Germans and Jews. And so therefore, this issue of preservation, I mentioned purity earlier, keep the blood pure. The blood becomes contaminated when Germans and Jews, or Germans and anyone else, begin to mix. So this essentially is a law mandating or essentially outlawing any kind of miscegenation. So there's a bunch of laws. I'm not going to read them all to you. I put the slides up for you. You can look at them. But I do want to just highlight a couple of things, because one of the things that maybe people don't realize are the number of laws the Nazis put into place between 1933 and 1939 to eliminate the rights of Jews in Germany. So they're astounding in many ways. Some of them focus on very basic, almost everyday things, quotidian things, like Jews can no longer, well, essentially serve as doctors for the Berlin city. Some of them are much more radical. Jews can no longer be in government service up here. Jews are no longer admitted to the legal profession. Dual number of Jews in schools and universities become limited. You have the revocation of citizenship of naturalized Jews and other undesirables. This ends up being Sinti and Roma, so-called gypsies, and also a number of other groups that over time. Jews are no longer able to have editorial posts, and so again, banning who can say what and where. Jewish officers are expelled from the army. The race laws exclude Jews from citizenship, as we've talked about already. They can't be tax consultants, they can't be veterinarians, they can't be teachers. And finally, Jewish children are banned from public school in 1937. This continues to accelerate. 1938 is a very interesting year because it culminates in the first state terror that is entirely all-encompassing for the country of Germany and Austria, and that's Kristallnacht, the Night of Broken Glass. And we'll talk about that in a second. But before that, you have a number of other things that happen. Jews can't change their name, so they can be identified. If you change your name, potentially you won't be identifiable. They can't hold guns. All Jewish businesses can't change their name either. Eventually, all Jewish businesses are turned over to the state or have to be turned over to the state. Some of the things that I think are really remarkable, by 1938, you have the confiscation of Jewish property by the state. You also have the invalidation of all German passports held by Jews. All new passports are marked with the letter J so that they're identifiable. Jews also have to all carry the first name of Israel if you're a man, or Sarah if you're a woman. Amazing, right? They're asking you to change your name so that you're identifiable clearly as a Jew. Things are getting bad. And then you have the pogrom of Kristallnacht in 1938. And we'll get to that in a second. But follow that, the closing of all Jewish businesses, the expelling of all Jewish children from schools, restrictions on movement, forbidding of Jews to keep carrier pigeons. weird, right? Communication. They can't have phones either. This is amazing. What you've done is you've isolated a group and you've cut them off from the outside world. And you've done so using all the authority of the state, the legal authority of the state that you usurped. So let's go back a little bit to the logic of fascism. We talked about ideology already. We talked about racism. We talked about the squelching of dissent and democratic rights. We talked about the elimination of checks and balances. There's a nice German word for that, which is Gleichschaltung, which literally means conformity, putting into line, putting into order. Joseph Goebbels, the head propaganda minister, will talk about the role of propaganda of producing a Gleichschaltung, meaning a kind of a worldview where everyone agrees. Suspension of rights and citizenship, and now I want to turn to propaganda. So the next part I'm going to go to is here. Propaganda, mass spectacles, dismantling of the independent media, and the ways in which fascism invents its own history, invents its own facts, invents its own truth. And then the end point is you enforce that truth through terror, and therefore you turn to totalitarianism. Okay, this is Joseph Goebbels. Goebbels had a post in Nazi Germany of head of the Ministry of Propaganda. He participated in many of the mass spectacles and rallies organized by the Nazi state in the 1930s, some of which were very famous, like this one in the picture at the bottom there, is a book burning outside of the Humboldt University, the University in Berlin. Literally across the street from the Humboldt University. The books came primarily from its library. So imagine a bunch of Nazi thugs going to Powell, taking out all the undesirable books, which are generally books written by Jews, communists, people like Magnus Hirschfeld, people supporting sexuality and various rights, burn them in a mass conflagration outside the library, and do so in a kind of nighttime rally, a kind of purging of ideas. This happens in Berlin in 1933. What's Goebbels' view of propaganda? Well, for him, propaganda is precisely about dismantling the independent media. You can't have thoughts that are outside the government. Propaganda is all about aligning a worldview or an idea with precisely what the government wants to do. He writes about the press. The press must not merely inform, it has to instruct. It has to tell people things, okay? It doesn't report on the news, it instructs them to believe things. I turn, first of all, to explicitly national press. Gentlemen, you too will consider ideal a situation in which the press is so finely tuned that it is, as it were, like a piano in the hands of the government on which the government can play. Imagine the press like a piano in the hands of the government. It plays songs. The people hear them. They're instructed. They obey. Extraordinary vision, right? This is a totalitarian vision. This is a vision about precisely getting rid of freedom of speech and freedom of thought. This is an Orwellian vision. This is 1984, right? This is precisely to get rid of free thought. Everything that Goebbels and Hitler were involved with in propaganda was that, making a piano in the hands of the government, controlling the press, controlling what's heard, what's seen, what's played. And so how do you do this? Of course, you do this by control. You do this by working, by dismantling independent media, and by using new technologies in order to get your message out there. One of the most interesting, I mean, I think interesting because she lived so long, she lived until 2003, was Leni Riefenstahl, Hitler's so-called filmmaker. She filmed and chronicled many of the rallies and events in Nazi Germany, very famously the 1936 Berlin Olympics. If you saw, if you've maybe seen more contemporary films, the film about Jesse Owens, much of the footage was actually shot by her. Chronicles, this particular film segment that I asked you to look at, is a four-day Nazi Party rally in Nuremberg, attended by some 700,000 members of the SA, the SS, and other Nazi supporters, some very popular in a sense of, you know, children, Hitler youth. You saw men and women. You also saw military formations. This was created to be a spectacle. It was created to be a film. And so the techniques that she used, the camera angles, the high altitude camera angles, the camera underneath Hitler to make him look bigger than life, the camera on a moving car in order to pan through the crowds, the camera high up in order to establish the scope and grandness. These were very innovative film techniques that she developed, and in many ways she's been praised for those techniques. But it's also interesting to show how those techniques were also complicit with creating a fascist worldview. And that worldview is precisely about the consolidation of power. So in the film, you have Hitler, you have Heinrich Himmler, you have Goebbels, you have Rudolf Hess, many others, the leadership of the Nazis in this period. This is a still from the film that kind of demonstrates what I would call the fascist spectacle. And it's in some ways, you know, it's megalomaniacal. In some ways, it is hugely monumental, right? You have rows and rows of tens of thousands of soldiers lined up in formation. You have a kind of, this is, if you're in an art history, and this is the perfect example of the vanishing point, right? It's a kind of Renaissance perspectival vision of you kind of go deep into the space, and what do you see at the very end? You see the Nazi insignia, right? You have the paying respect to the fallen soldiers, because again, it's coming out of the First World War. It's paying, you know, your respects to their having fallen for the nation. It's obviously militaristic. It's extremely masculinist. They're almost all men here. There's a sense of its totality. It's almost unending. You know, as far as the eye can see, it's soldiers after soldiers after soldiers, and of course, the great leaders in the front are the right here. Those are the three. It's Himmler, Hitler, and Lütze in the front there. He was the head of the SA briefly. That was the stormtroopers. And you could say this is literally, and the German word here I mentioned earlier, that idea of conformity, gleichgeschaltet. Everything's in line. Everything's been ordered. A sense of totality, right? A sense of infallibility, a sense of oneness. That's sort of the fascist idea. And you perform this. You perform it in space. The film was actually shown in many places throughout Germany in 1935. It was a hit, one of the top grossing films in Germany that year, one of the top grossing films in Germany during the Nazi years, in fact. And so it was meant to be shown to people who couldn't attend these rallies. And so it was used as a piece of Nazi propaganda in film palaces throughout Germany. See if I have there's a little thing I was going to show you. Oops, so I can get this. Hello. I was going to show you the very first part of that real quick. I don't want to spend much time on this, but I should also say that one of the things that I think is... Whoa. Yeah, all right, Fox. I'm going to let that play. Get rid of our advertisement. Oh, skip ad, we can do that. That's great. Glad we can skip the ad. Yeah, when you rely on YouTube, you know, you rely on YouTube. Oy vey. It's back. Come on. Skip ad. All right. I just wanted to show you the little part where Hitler lands. Yeah, and I just wanted to say something about this. Oh, God, come on. There it is. Okay, so he's about to land. Maybe we should go a little earlier. We'll turn the sound back on because it does have sound. So she's using cameras in blimps and getting all this aerial footage, you know, on the ground of the masses assembling on the parade route for where Hitler will be driven on his way to a rally. So a sense of obviously imminent excitement, the cheering masses, obviously the Sieg Heil kind of performances, the young and the old is a kind of similarity of every single person there. Obviously, not just very white, but very Aryan looking. He's their leader. He emerges from the sky like a god in technology, the airplane, right? Touching down in Nuremberg, one of the oldest kind of medieval fortified cities, has a long history of excluding Jews. In fact, they built a wall around the darn thing because the Jews couldn't live in the city. And so in many ways, it's a symbolic, the city has a symbolic history of anti-Semitism built into the history of the city. He arrives in Nuremberg in 1934, but go back several hundred years and you have the history of Jews also being excluded. So this is a celebration of, this is a celebration of white supremacy. And it's a celebration that's not only filmed in a way that shows its kind of inevitability, its breadth, its kind of popular dimensions of everyone rallying and singing and shouting and happy, but there's an outside to this film. The outside are precisely those people that never are depicted in it, right? It's the victims, it's the scapegoats, it's anyone who deviates from this world. This film is about presenting a worldview, and then it's shown popularly throughout Germany, so you identify with it. I'm part of this movement. I see myself in them, in this rally, in this popular movement, right? And Hitler is my savior. It's our God. He moves through the masses. So, in the interest of time, I am going to move back along this. Oops. There we go. Current slide. Oops. Go. So, there's a couple of things I want to get to today. So, there's a couple of things I want to see if it. So, we had mentioned Kristallnacht as a kind of a real sort of a turning point. And I think. And it really is, because of the way I think about terror. This is the first time that the state systematically terrorized a population. So you had all these laws already put in place, you had all these exclusion, you had the idea of taking away citizenship, but you didn't have a performative creation of terror run by the state organizations. And I mean the military, the police, public servants, and the paramilitary, okay? All these different groups buying into and participating in the ideology and destroying Jewish synagogues, homes, businesses, and the result is, and I'll give you kind of like the numbers here, 267 synagogues throughout Germany and Austria over the period of a single night and day destroyed. You have the Baden-Baden synagogue and the Frankfurt synagogue on fire at the bottom there. You have 7,500 Jewish businesses broken or looted. You have 91 Jews killed and 30,000 sent to concentration camps. And this is before what we call the Holocaust started. This is November 9th and 10th, 1938. Why it happened? I mean, there's lots of reasons given. Ostensibly, it was in retaliation for the murder by a Polish Jew, a guy named Herschel Grinspan, of a German embassy official named Ernst von Rath. So this was almost like retaliation for that. It was seen by Goebbels and Hitler's as, we didn't cause this. This was a public display of sentiment, the outrage that a Polish Jew could have killed a German. And so when this was carried out, it was not only carried out by units of the Gestapo, the SS, and the paramilitary, but also by public servants like police and firefighters who either contributed or did not stop it. The only time they intervened in fires was when Aryan property would be burned, so next door. So this is really extraordinary. You have the state, you know, producing terror. Now, there was a long kind of history of this. I mean, that is to say, there was already terror in some ways through the imagery. These are just two publications by the Nazis. Der Stürmer is like the storm. And it says, really, it's very interesting, German weekly for the fight for truth. So it's about truth, our facts, our propaganda. What is our truth? Well, it says right here, the Jews are our misfortune, die Juden sind unser Unglück, and whoever shops at Jewish stores is a traitor to his race. right? We squish the Jew here. Similar kind of things here. Who are the enemies of the state? I show you these two publications partially because I want you to understand that the propaganda was not just in film, but also in print, and because it was critical in consolidating a kind of public sentiment that the very ideas of elimination and segregation and getting rid of the Jews, not just articulated in 1919 by Hitler, but also articulated throughout the Hitler regime and accelerated right after Kristallnacht, right after 1938. So I had given you one of the last pieces I asked you to read was this piece called What Now, Jews? So, Juden, was nun? I mean, can you imagine that being asked? What are you going to do now? This is 2 weeks after Kristallnacht, published in the newspaper, this one on the right, Das Schwarze Korps, so the black, you know, corps. It says, this is a newspaper, by the way, founded, the official SS newspaper. It was founded in 1935. It had a circulation of several hundred thousand throughout Germany. At its height, it was close to 1 million. We will finally move toward a total solution to the Jewish question. The agenda has been set, and this is what it is. Complete elimination, absolute segregation. This is in print. It's in 1938. It's in print by the official newspaper of the SS and circulated throughout Germany. Why? And it gives a reason. Again, the construction of facts. Well, the Jews have wrecked the German national economy with their murderous deeds and their inquisitionist war and murder mongering. Again, it invents its history. It invents its reasons. It comes up with its facts, and therefore it proposes an idea. It proposes, you know, an action. And this, I gave this to you also because I was so surprised. I hadn't really seen calls articulated this clearly in 1938, but it basically says, send them to cattle cars. The Jews, therefore, must be driven out of our apartment buildings and neighborhoods and dispatched to cattle cars or barracks where they'll remain among themselves and have as little contact as possible with Germans. They must be clearly marked and furthermore stripped of the right to own their homes and property. In a major newspaper in 1938, circulated throughout Germany. All right, I'm gonna move towards conclusions because I want you to kind of reflect now on sort of fascism. So we talked about fascism emerging at an opportune moment. That opportune moment is political fragmentation. It's where the far left and the far right are basically fighting with each other, where coalitions are not being built across, I would say, lines. You have what I would say compromise and acquiescence, meaning parties more in the center. I mean, even the German Nationalist Party was not as far to the right as the Nazis, but they compromised in order to put him in power. Others acquiesced, like Hindenburg, to appoint him. So you have people who are probably good people, maybe even who didn't even necessarily hold as radical or even maybe even not even racist views, who acquiesced in a moment of crisis and helped the leader, Hitler, gain power. If I was to be vigilant of fascism, this is one of the things that I began to think about. I look at people who compromise in moments of fragmentation. I look at people who acquiesce. You have an outside leader rising to power by promising the rebirth of the nation, giving voice to a silent majority. The silent majority are people who felt disaffected. Workers, lower middle class, soldiers, rural populations. It pits the city against the rural. Cities are places of decadence because they're progressive. It's where the Jews are, it's where the intellectuals are, it's where the people with money are. It's where the homosexuals are, right? Berlin was never a safe haven for the Nazis. Berlin was hated because it illustrated everything that was about internationalism. It was always the rural populations. And remember, Germany had 67 million people in it. The vast majority didn't live in cities. The vast majority lived in the provinces. Scapegoats. Well, the scapegoats here, Jews, homosexuals, communists, blame for decline. They have to be ever more excluded radically. And that's, of course, done legally. It celebrates the return to order, the family, patriarchy, racial, ethnic, national purity, purification, blood. Socially conservative in this respect, because it wants to reestablish something that, you know, something like, you know, patriarchy, heteronormativity, but also modern, because it uses rallies, film, radio, to get its message across, these mass spectacles. The Nazis weren't stupid. They realized that film was a popular medium. You can use it. Their films would be popular, and they were. It invents its own history. It invents facts. It destroys the independent media. It demonizes dissent. Where does this go? Seven. I begin to worry, you should begin to worry, when the police, the military, the paramilitary, public servants, armed citizens begin to intermingle and merge. This happened, this is Kristallnacht. When you no longer have the police serving the citizens, you no longer have the firefighters protecting property, you no longer have the military separate from the police, who are separate from people who happen to own guns, when they all intermingle, there's a problem. Terror. State terror that has no recourse. Fascism usually comes to power, accelerates its power by a political ruse, a crisis, a terrorist act, a Reichstag fire. I say, be aware of these things. It declares a state of emergency precisely to suspend constitutional powers. It eliminates checks and balances. It gets rid of due process. It gets rid of constitutional freedoms. It does so very efficiently. Its lies become prophecy. Prophecy becomes truth. What does that mean? Lies become prophecy. The lies about the Jews have done this and done this, we must destroy them. It becomes what they're going to do. The predictions become actions. The actions become taken for truth. How do you enforce truth? Well, through infallibility. There's no recourse. Through terror. And finally, through annihilation. It's in this regard that fascism becomes totalitarianism, and I would say Kristallnacht is the closest we get to the beginnings of the turn from a fascist regime to a totalitarian regime. And of course, this accelerates, and what we'll see between 1939 and 1945, this is also why you get the Holocaust. Last slide, I'm gonna leave you with kind of a reflection, and then if we have a moment, we can ask questions too. I'm gonna read you this, and I'm gonna help you kind of unpack it a little bit. This was written by a very significant German Jewish philosopher, thinker, political scientist named Hannah Arendt. She was the first person to analyze where did totalitarianism come from. She did this, the book actually first came out in 1948, it was revised in 1951. She looked at Stalinism and Hitlerism in comparative fashion, and she did so by looking at the history of anti-Semitism, the history of colonialism, all the way up to how they came to power and what they did. And we'll read a small section of her book, I think in week three, just a small piece. She also wrote a piece where she was at the trial of Adolf Eichmann and tried to understand like what actions, how he as a human being could have turned into the kind of mastermind of the deportation of the Jews. And so she was at his trial in Israel in 1961. But what she writes in 1951 is really extraordinary, and it has to do with why the outside world has failed to negate a totalitarian regime. Like, what did it do wrong? So here's what she said. It has been one of the chief handicaps of the outside world in dealing with totalitarian systems that it ignored the system. It ignored the totalitarian system and therefore trusted that on the one hand, the very enormity of the totalitarian lies would be their undoing. So it trusted that, hey, if you just like make up these lies and they're so radical, that's gonna be your undoing, because it's just like they're lies, they're so big, they're crazy. It trusted that would be their undoing, and on the other hand, that it would be possible to take the leader at his word and force him, regardless of his original intentions, to make good. Meaning, you're gonna say, look, you said these things, but you know they're wrong. Like, you're gonna use rational debate to debate with the autocrat, to debate with the authoritarian leader. You're gonna say, no, these things that you're saying are not true, and we'll give you evidence and facts to support it. But guess what? The totalitarian system is foolproof against such normal consequences. This is, normal consequences are debate. Normal consequences are evidence. Normal consequences are arguments. Its ingeniousness rests precisely on the elimination of that reality which either unmasks the liar or forces him to live up to his pretense, his false claims. The ingeniousness of the totalitarian system is that it's foolproof against any attempt to debate with it. It eliminates reality. It makes its own reality. Now that's really interesting. How do you negate it? What do? It's scary, right? Anyways, food for thought. No questions, I'll take them for the next couple minutes. Nothing. It's a lot. Think about this. It's honestly, it's up to us to figure out how to respond. Thanks.